Welcome to Standard High Online Teaching. You're with Jane Andrew, taking you through History Paper 1. That is P210/1, African Nations and New States. Today, we want to visit something very interesting. We want to visit the Portuguese colonies. I'm aware all the candidates out there, all the learners of especially African nationalism, you must be fully aware that we had several colonial masters on the African continent. We had the British, we had the French, we had the Italians, especially we remember the Italians invading Ethiopia. We had Spain. We shall enjoy Spain at one point, especially in Western Sahara. But we cannot forget we equally had Portugal. And out of all these colonial masters, we even had the Belgians, and so on and so forth. Our interest today is basically in the Portuguese colonies. Portugal equally had colonies, just like all these other colonial masters had colonies in Africa. But there is something very interesting with the Portuguese colonies. When we talk of the Portuguese colonies, we are specifically referring to four colonies. That is Angola, Mozambique, Cape Verde, and Guinea-Bissau. Angola, what is very interesting, she was the first colonial master on the African continent. If I'm to take you back to your O-level history, the coming of foreigners on the African continent, specifically we can even zero it to East African coast. We shall talk of the Arabs, then we shall later talk of the Portuguese, or we can even begin it right from the coming of the Portuguese, and then later the Arabs. So that is how the Portuguese occupied the East African coast very, very early, the first colonial masters or the first foreigners to come to Africa. But of course we know, even when they were still at the East African coast, with the coming of the Arabs, the Portuguese increasingly lost grip on the African coast, and they ended up entering into the interior of Africa. And that is how they ended up concentrating in the areas of Angola, Mozambique, Cape Verde, and Guinea-Bissau. Having occupied these areas, it increasingly became difficult for the Portuguese to ever think of granting independence. Whereas all these other colonial masters, Britain, France, Belgium, later granted independence to their subjects or to their colonies, it was not the case on the side of the Portuguese. It was very difficult for the Portuguese. Actually, had it not been the Lisbon coup in 1970, it would have been very difficult. Actually, 1974, it would have been very difficult for the Portuguese to develop the idea of granting independence to their colonies. Now, our concern today is the slow growth of nationalism in the Portuguese colonies. Why did it take long for the Africans to wake up, to rise up for independence? The growth, the level, the desire to have self-determination, to have self-rule in the Portuguese colonies was very, very slow. Whereas in all these other African countries, the Africans quickly picked up arms right from 1945. By 1960, most of the African countries were truly at the peak of struggling. The Portuguese colonies, a bigger number of years. You can imagine the Portuguese colonies only began attaining independence in 1975, when almost all the other African countries had at least attained independence, except for a few. Now, we want to look at those reasons that delayed independence in the Portuguese colonies. Listeners and all students, much as today we are looking at the Portuguese colonies, these are the very reasons that will explain why any other African country took long to attain independence. These reasons will cut across. Let it be the French colonies of Algeria, Tunisia, Morocco, Madagascar. Let it be the British colonies. Let it be in Western Sahara. Let it be any other area where Europeans colonized. The reasons why Africans took long to struggle and attain independence or self-rule, these will remain the same. Although today we are basically focusing on the Portuguese colonies. Don't forget, when we talk of the Portuguese colonies, we shall concentrate on Angola, Mozambique, Cape Verde, and Guinea-Bissau. The very first reason will be the high levels of illiteracy. High levels of illiteracy amongst the Africans. It is very true that if Africans were to attain independence, then we needed a group of educated men who are ready to steerhead, who are ready to run politics or the affairs of these countries. Unfortunately, in the early years, we did not have that advantage. Africans were very, very illiterate. For example, you look at a country like Angola. 20% of Angola's population were illiterate. 20%. So sorry, 80%. Only 20% had attained, actually not even 20%, 2% had attained some level of education. Majority were illiterate, who did not even understand the meaning of independence. They did not even understand the need for self-rule. Now, with that kind of population that was illiterate, this was not only in Angola, even when I'm citing out Angola. This was the case in Mozambique. This was the case in Cape Verde. But it was the worst story in all these other areas of Africa. For example, look at a country like Congo in 1960, by the time she got independence. The whole country had only around 17 graduates. I don't know how many graduates Uganda had by 1962. So we still had that problem of high levels of illiteracy. That therefore explains why we had fewer people ready to join politics, ready to join the liberation movements or struggles for independence. Then the other thing was the high levels of poverty amongst the Portuguese on Portugal as a country. Portugal as a country was, and she's still, a poor nation, a poor country. But by then it was even worse of a story. So Portugal looked at African colonies as her source of wealth. Don't forget, she was siphoning resources, minerals, from African countries. Angola was heavily endowed with minerals, and so was Mozambique. So Portugal looked at these colonies as purely her backbone, as the source of her wealth, because she was a poor country. In any case, these African colonies would meet three quarters of Portugal's annual budget. The budget of Portugal was financed, was supported by African countries. Therefore, it was very difficult for Portugal to ever surrender. It's like having your parents who are entirely supporting you. Without your parents, without you, the student listening. Therefore, there is no way you can ever give out your parent or you can ever sacrifice your parent. This was Portugal, that she could never grant independence to African countries or to her colonies, because granting independence meant crippling her economy. Then the other thing was the restriction on movements of the Africans. Africans were never allowed to move. And what was the secret? What was the logic? We have always had these cases, even in Kenya. Africans were never allowed to move. In Tanzania, it was the very case. In South Africa, it was worst pronounced. In Zimbabwe, it was worse. And so are the cases in Namibia and all these other African countries. Why? Any movement of the Africans would mean interacting with other Africans or other African nationalists. Perhaps in the process of interacting, they would forge out methodologies of fighting to attain independence. They would share common interests. So what the Portuguese did was to restrict movements of the Africans, especially within the colonies of Angola, Mozambique, and Guinea-Bissau. If they were to move, if Africans were to ever move, then they were to only go to South Africa, because there were still restrictions in South Africa of the British. They were to only cross to Southern Rhodesia. Those were the only areas if they were to move. Now, by restricting the movements of the Africans, that had now blocked their interactions, their nationalistic or sharing of nationalistic ideas. So they remained very backward. They remained behind curtains. They would therefore never develop any inspiration to struggle for independence. Then the other reason that explains why the Portuguese colonies were very slow at rising up for independence. And I still remind you, this does not only apply to Portuguese colonies, but these are the very reasons, dear students, why all these other African countries delayed to attain independence. At one point, they can ask you, account for delayed independence in Morocco, account for delayed independence in Tunisia, account for delayed independence or growth of nationalism in southern Rhodesia. Then you begin crying that our teacher never taught us that. As long as I've taught you reasons why it took long the Portuguese colonies to rise up for independence, these were Africans, and these are the very reasons that apply to even all these other African countries. And we are saying the other reason was the efficient espionage or spy network. The Portuguese established a very strict police and spy network, PIDE, that was in charge of arresting, torturing, beating up any nationalist or any upcoming nationalistic ideas or sentiments. Now, this kept Africans in total fear. We shall look at several cases where Africans, even those who tried to protest in Angola, were shot dead. Those who tried to demonstrate in Mozambique were equally shot dead. We are yet to look at that. So the strictness of this spy network kept on informing the Portuguese administration on any development, and any African who would be suspected would equally be dealt with brutally, ruthlessly. For example, we shall talk of Eduardo Mondlane in Mozambique, who was assassinated, he was tortured, he was arrested, tortured, and eventually killed. We shall look at Amilcar Cabral in Guinea-Bissau. He was equally tortured and eventually killed. This left all the other nationalists, or even those others who would think of struggling for independence, very scared and perhaps gave up on this idea. This explains why the idea of joining struggles for independence was very slow. Then the Portuguese military strength. The Portuguese had almost a tune of 200,000 soldiers. These were just not ordinary soldiers. They were well trained, well equipped with modern artillery of the time compared to the poor Africans. And you shall pick it from that very point. Thank you so much.